In a basic calculus course, you may have encountered the sine hyperbolic and cosine hyperbolic function. By then you may have wondered what they had to do with the sine and cosine. They are a combination of exponentials. You can now make this connection. In this video, we will introduce the complex hyperbolic functions and we'll see that the link to the real sine and cosine is really straightforward. So, how are they defined? F from C to C, f of z equals sine hyperbolic of z, just as in the real case, e to the power z minus e to the power minus z, and similarly for the cosine hyperbolic g, cosine hyperbolic of z equals e to the power z, now plus e to the power minus z. Well, they are entire functions, because they are a combination of exponentials, and if you differentiate the sine hyperbolic, you get the 1 half e to the power z, from this one you get the minus 1, so you get plus e to the power minus z, which gives you the cosine hyperbolic. And if you differentiate the cosine hyperbolic, your e to the power z remains the same, and the e to the power minus z gives you a minus e to the power minus z, so you get 1 half e to the power z minus e to the power minus z equals the sine hyperbolic of z. So what's the relation with the trigonometric functions? Well, if you take a look at sine of z, then you have e to the power iz minus e to the power minus iz. If you multiply that with I, you get a 1/2 instead of 1 over 2i. And then you notice that that's the same as the sine hyperbolic of I times z. If you plug in I times z over here, you get exactly I times the sine of z. Similarly for the cosine of z, that's 1/2 e to the power iz plus e to the power minus iz, which is the same as the cosine hyperbolic. If you plug in I times z over here, then you get 1/2 e to the power I times z plus e to the power minus I times z. So you see cosine and cosine hyperbolic and sine hyperbolic are closely related. So you can use this, for example, to derive some identities. You know sine z squared plus cosine z squared equals 1. Now you know the sine of z equals minus I times the sine hyperbolic of z. So if you square the sine of z, you have minus I times sine hyperbolic squared iz yields the minus sine squared hyperbolic. And if you square the cosine, that's just the same as squaring cosine hyperbolic of iz, so you get 1. So you notice that if you substitute w equals I times z, you get cosine hyperbolic squared minus sine hyperbolic squared of w equals 1. You can do this for all w, so this holds for all w in C. Very similar to this formula of the sine and the cosine. Now, how can we find all zeros, for example, of a sine hyperbolic of w? Well, you substitute z equals minus iw first, then you get sine hyperbolic w, a setting z equals minus iw over here, and it gives you I times the sine of w. So if you want to set this to zero, that means it's sine hyperbolic w equals zero if the sine of I times w equals zero. You know when this is the case, if the argument of the sine is a multiple of pi, so I times w is a multiple of pi, or if w equals minus k pi I, where k can be anything in z, so k tilde times pi times I. So finding the zeros of like sine hyperbolic is not so difficult, and for the cosine hyperbolic it goes in the same way, and we can use this to find some information about the hyperbolic tangent function. Hyperbolic tangent equals sine hyperbolic z divided by cosine hyperbolic of z. Well, it's zero if the numerator is zero, so the zeros are the same as the zeros of the sine hyperbolic, so k times pi times I, and the singularities are whenever you're dividing by zero, those are the zeros of the cosine hyperbolic, and similarly to the sine hyperbolic, you can find them as minus pi over 2 times I plus k times 2 pi I, where k is in z. So you see the hyperbolic functions are very closely related to the sine and the cosine, and dealing with this type of functions is, well, not so difficult. It's equally difficult as dealing with the sine and the cosine.